Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome in. Trevor Lane here for LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. Game 3 tonight. The playoffs come back to Staples Center. By the way, guys, make sure you do join us tonight for our LakersNation.com watch party over at State Social House in West Hollywood. It's going to be a ton of fun. Doors open at 6:30. First 40 people in the door do get a LakersNation.com swag bag. But let's talk about what the Lakers need to do in order to get the win tonight against the Suns and go up 2-1 in the series. Joining me is Ron Gutterman from LakersNation.com. Ron, how are you doing, man? And what are you thinking about the Lakers potentially going up 2-1 in this series tonight?
Yeah, I mean, we all knew how important Game 2 was, getting that win, stealing back home court advantage in this series. We all knew how important it was, and I'm glad that, you know, the Lakers were able to get it done. They made some adjustments, some obvious adjustments from Game 1. And so, you know, this is what a playoff series is about. It's constantly making adjustments. I think the Suns are going to look very different tonight than they did two nights ago, and the Lakers will have to adjust on the fly to what the Suns are doing.
So what are your keys then in order to get the win tonight? Because you know the Suns are going to throw some different wrinkles at the Lakers. I wouldn't be surprised if we saw more of the double screens. We saw a lot of the 1-5 pick and roll action out of the Suns in the last game, particularly to target Marc Gasol. But what do you think the Lakers are going to need to do in order to get the W tonight? Let's just go back and forth and start firing off some keys for the win on this one.
Yeah, I think a big key for this one is, weirdly enough, I actually think LeBron James is going to need to be a little bit more active. In the first two games, I think he was very passive. He had 23 points, 9 assists, 4 rebounds. That's, you know, that's good, but it's not what we've come to expect from LeBron James. So I think he is going to need to be a little more active in demanding the pace and controlling the pace of the game. He's one of the best to ever do it in terms of his ability to just completely control the way in which a game operates. And he kind of hasn't been doing that for long stretches through the first two games of this series. So I'm really looking for him to dominate and leave his mark on this game to say, hey, look, we're not going down 1-2 and I'm going to make sure of it.
You know, I'm really interested to see what LeBron does look like tonight. I think the ankle is still bothering him. I think it's very clear he's not 100%. He is still active. He's still making an impact out there. But you look at his shots in the last game, 16 shots taken, 9 of them were threes. Only 3 of them were at the rim, and 2 of those were uncontested. So you're talking about 1 contested shot at the rim for LeBron James. Every other shot was out of the paint or a completely uncontested look. That tells you that that burst is just not quite there just yet. And I'm hoping that it'll come back a little bit for this one because, again, Anthony Davis, who I'm going to talk about here, he went off 34 points against the Phoenix Suns. But I think they're going to show some different looks at him compared to Game 2. They're going to do what they can to keep him off the free throw line. And that is then going to push a little bit more onto LeBron. I think you're going to need to see him in a bit more of aggressive mode. But getting back to my main point, though, Anthony Davis has got to have his foot down on the gas pedal from the opening tip. Again, I'm not expecting 34 points and 21 free throws or anything like that. Those numbers are simply not sustainable. He's going to get those burst games every now and then. But if you can get a nice, you know, 20 to 25 point performance out of Anthony Davis, double digit rebounds, block some shots, do some things on the defensive end, that's going to be enough for the Lakers, I think, for some other guys to pick up the slack. But if we revert to the Game 1 Anthony Davis, that's where the Lakers could be in trouble tonight at home.
Yeah, I completely agree. Anthony Davis needs to find a way to impact the game offensively without free throws. He's going to get his free throws. I saw a stat that the Lakers, since being traded to the Lakers, I think it's something like they're 25-3 when he shoots more than 10 free throws. I saw that stat circulating on Twitter during Game 2. So he needs to get to the line. He needs to do that, but he needs to find a way to operate offensively without free throws, because right now, you know, he shot 7-for-15. He still in this series has not found a way to impact the game with his pure scoring ability, and he has it. So I really want to see that from him. I actually want to switch to Anthony Davis defensively, yeah, because someone needs to do something about DeAndre Ayton.
Yes.
That dude has missed 2 shots the entire series. He is dominating in a way that DeAndre Ayton shouldn't dominate. And so I am putting a lot on Anthony Davis because, look, Andre Drummond, he played great in Game 2. He is not equipped to guard DeAndre Ayton the way Anthony Davis is. So I need Anthony Davis to step up and say, look, I am taking this matchup. I am not letting DeAndre Ayton do whatever he wants in the post. I'm going to make some of those shots contested rather than open dunks.
You know, Ron, when you say that Ayton has only missed two shots, like it sounds like a lie. It doesn't sound real. And yet here we are, and I've been watching these games intently. I've seen how impactful he has been out there on the floor. And I do think that Anthony Davis could go a long way towards slowing him down. I'll tell you what, we need this guy. We need 2020 playoffs Anthony Davis. I think we got him in game two, but the defensive end of the floor, he was a monster in the playoffs last season, and he had that outside jumper working so well. I thought he looked like an MVP caliber player in the playoffs. This is the guy that we need. And by the way, guys, if you want your very own Anthony Davis championship bobblehead, you can get it over at foco.com, F-O-C-O.com. They have all kinds of officially licensed fan gear, so make sure you guys check that out. Look, if you are going to run Anthony Davis on Ayton, that means AD at the five. The last game, game two, we saw them experiment with Marc Gasol at the five. And I thought it was okay. It worked out all right, especially in the offensive end. But we also saw the Suns target him a lot in pick and roll, in that 1-5 pick and roll. And in a lot of cases, with Gasol switched onto a guard, that was leading to open looks for Ayton. I think that's going to be key in this one. Not so much that you're going to stop Ayton, but just stop giving him so many uncontested looks. He's feasting on, look, he's a good player, but he's not the kind of player who should just never miss. The reason why he's not missing is because he's getting uncontested dunks time and time again out of the pick and roll. So the Lakers defending, that's going to be key. And I think Anthony Davis at the five could end up making a difference. It certainly made a difference at the end of game two.
Yeah, and I mean, look, this is a bit more experimental, but if you want to have Anthony Davis and Marc Gasol on the floor together, it might be worth experimenting to put Anthony Davis on DeAndre Ayton and have Marc Gasol kind of be a help defender that sort of trails out on Jay Crowder as well and contests those threes that he shoots. I actually think that's worth experimenting with because Anthony Davis's activity is going to make life a lot harder for DeAndre Ayton and for that pick and roll than Marc Gasol ever could.
They tried it a little bit in game two. Gasol, it was just one play. Gasol and Davis switched really quick right before the screen was going to go be set. So AD was the guy to come up on the guard. And as I recall, the Suns were still able to generate something out of it, but it was really interesting to see. And I wouldn't be surprised if we start to see more wrinkles like that, where suddenly you get Gasol defending somebody else, because I do think that he was a benefit on the offensive end. Yeah. Let me tell you, the other thing that I'm been looking for in tonight's game, one of the keys, it's not even the Lakers themselves, it's the fans. Staples Center needs to be rocking. This is the first playoff game for the Lakers at Staples Center since 2013. No one on the team right now has played a playoff game at Staples Center as a Laker. It sounds insane because they're the reigning defending 17-time NBA champions, but last season was in the bubble. So they have not had that experience. The Staples Center crowd needs to try to mimic the effect that we saw the crowd have on the Phoenix Suns in Phoenix. Going to be really important that the crowd is there, that they're loud, that they're fired up, and they're showing the Lakers that support, because that is something that they haven't seen in a long, long time, given everything that we've been dealing with. So I think the crowd is going to be a factor in tonight's game.
Yeah, and you know, there's one person in particular whose name I'm looking at who might benefit the most from a crowd being behind him and supporting him, Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. He has been really, really not good offensively. He's been good defensively. I don't want to discredit what he's done against Devin Booker and Chris Paul. He has been wonderful defensively in this series. Offensively, it's looked bad. It's been rough. It's, you know, we saw when he passed up a wide open three and LeBron James gave him the business at the next timeout.
I love that.
I need the aggressive Kentavious Caldwell-Pope that we saw in the first month of this season, in last year's playoffs, and in the last month of this regular season. I need that, KCP.
Yes. No, and to go. No,
yeah.
And to go even further, it's not even just KCP. Like, look, KCP has not hit a three in this series yet. KCP hasn't hit a three. Like, how ridiculous is that? Ayton not missing, barely missing, sounds like a lie. Just like KCP not hitting a three in the whole series so far sounds like a lie. Who would have predicted that? But here we are. But LeBron was right to get on him. The Lakers need him to continue shooting. And here's the other thing that I'm looking for. You're right. Maybe the crowd does act as a factor in this. Role players tend to shoot better at home. So I need to see the other guys step up. Last game, almost all of the Lakers' points were scored by four people. It was LeBron, Anthony Davis, of course, Dennis Schroeder, and Andre Drummond. That was it. They scored almost every single point for the Lakers because nobody else really got going. Marc Gasol hit a couple of threes here and there. I think Caruso had a little turnaround in the lane, but that was about it, right? So the other guys, I'm not saying they need to go on crazy scoring binges, but just knock down the open threes that LeBron and Davis and the rest create. That's it. If you can knock those down at a decent clip, and KCP is a big part of this, the Lakers go from being a pretty good team that can get the win to a team that can blow out this Suns team. Again, if they shot even a respectable amount, the other guys on the team shot a respectable number from three last game would have been a blowout win for the Lakers. So that's what I'm looking for. KCP is the number one guy. He's the main guy that's got to get that shot going, but everybody else too has got to be able to connect on their threes at a respectable clip, and that pushes the Lakers to a whole new level.
Yeah, and to show you, to illustrate how much of a new level they could get to, the Suns outshot them from the field, from the three-point line, and from the free throw line in game two. And the Lakers won by seven. So all you need to do, I mean, just shoot better than 30% from three, shoot better than 45% from the field, and you're a whole different team. And that starts with Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. It starts with Wes Matthews. It starts with Kyle Kuzma. It starts with a lot of these guys that haven't been producing offensively, even though all of their defense has been incredible this series.
And that's the other thing, Ron. You know, when I look at this series, I look at the way the Lakers played in this last game. I saw a lot of mistakes. I saw a lot of times where two guys went to one player that was cutting and they left open a wide open person. Stuff where the Lakers are going to come back, they're going to look in their film session and they're going to go, oh man, we blew it there. We blew it there. We gave them open looks here. We gave them a lot of opportunities. If they can clean things up a little bit, that's my final point. Just get moderately better across the board at some of the little things that just not having enough chemistry, enough time on the floor together can create. Some of the little miscues would go a long, long way for this team.
Yeah, and like you mentioned, look, 96 of their 109 points came from those four players: Anthony Davis, LeBron James, Dennis Schroeder, Andre Drummond. The other guys need to step up. KCP and the bench unit need to step up. They need to be better. I am challenging at least, let's go out on a limb, I'm challenging two of those players to hit double-digit points tonight.
How about our guy Kyle Kuzma? Has not been scoring the ball much at all in this series. Done some decent things defensively, but I think he could be a guy. So they could easily put up double-digit points, but again, got to get there, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it's got to be. I'm challenging two of those guys for sure.
All right. Well, guys, let us know your thoughts in the comments down below about the Lakers heading into game three. What are your keys to victory? Obviously, I think that they've got a really good shot to win this thing, especially with the home crowd behind them, but got to take care of business and got to make sure that they do really get the job done in terms of their shooting, in terms of their rebounding, which we didn't mention, continuing to control the offensive glass like they did last game. That's going to be really important as well. Defensively, dealing with that pick and roll. There's a lot of things that can make the Lakers actually a lot better. And that's got me optimistic for the future. The Lakers right now are barely scratching the surface of their potential. Some little improvement across the board in a few key areas that I think we're going to see in time. And this team can actually be much, much better than the squad we saw that just beat the Phoenix Suns in game two. So that is exciting stuff. Let me know again in the comments down below what you think the Lakers need to do in order to get the win tonight. And don't forget to subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Till next time, see ya and stay safe.